offering is the truth. Nothing more. Good evening, everyone, and welcome to episode one of Debunking Professor Dumdave. Okay, I've had a lot of truthers coming to me lately talking about this Professor Dave character who supposedly has these 10 challenges for flat earthers. Now, personally, I haven't watched any of this guy's videos except for the 10 challenges that a friend sent me yesterday saying there's this guy with a goofy YouTube channel that tries to debunk flat earth videos and conspiracy videos. So anyways, before I watched the video, I went on to his Facebook just to kind of see what, you know, people said about him in the comments, being that he calls himself a professor. So let's check that out first. 3.8 star, not bad. Okay, we have Nicholas here who says, pseudoscience and fictitious claims, nothing but lies from this fake professor. Okay, Simon, fairly knowledgeable on a good amount of topics, but an utterly poor debater, consistently leaning on a handful of keywords like triggered and fraud. Even if I find myself agreeing with many of his stances, his debating style is a mixture of ad hominem remarks mixed with a plethora of common logical fallacies commonly associated with those who consistently fail to address arguments brought up by his opponent. Does not seem to realize that being wrong isn't a sign of weakness, but owning up to it is. Okay, let's go to the next. Okay, we have Justin here who says, Professor Dave is a raging narcissistic monster who thinks he's never wrong. If a viewer disagrees with his thinking at all, he instantly accuses them of simply being hurt or debunking some myth of theirs. That's hopeful thinking on his part. Look at the other negative reviews as an example. That's exactly his response. The reality, however, is that he is hardly convincing of anything to anyone he doesn't like because of his terrible attitude and demeanor towards the public in general, even his own supporters. He can't imagine that a rational, objective thinker would ever disagree. Okay. Here we have Denny, who says, principles of inorganic chemistry. Okay. Elex says, pretends to know, hoax, regurgitating, rubbish, blissfully, unaware, lashing out like a toddler. Oh no, I did not intend to insult you, Professor. I was just diving into your vocabulary. Okay, Chris says, watching a debate he had where he begins with degrading his opponent, followed by a debate where he tried to create the topics to answer while evading everything and seemed discombobulated with the simplest yes or no's. He's used gravity that we don't physically see it, but its effects, but can't give verifiable logic, only repetitive hypotheses he claims his opponent made. He is a horrible debater and only belittles. A very awful person. Okay, Danielle says, just another hack without a job, has a silly YouTube channel that panders to idiots with baited content. Don't subscribe to this midwit. Now, that's pretty much what I've heard about the guy, but let's move on. With Michael, who says he could research his subjects better and he is not a professor. Okay, here we have Greg, who says because he's not willing to debate, he bans the voices he doesn't agree with. Dave is simply afraid to have a discussion. So sad. Via email, he is currently refusing to debate the topic, says I'm not worth his time. And Netline says, by being a better role model to kids watching, not sure if that's good or bad. Marcel, he does not research what he debunks enough. He's not a real scientist because he disproves other views and ridicules people by calling them mentally ill lunatics because they have different opinions. Also, often his comparisons are irrelevant. Okay, and here we have Reto. He is not really a professor. And then he has over here to the side, I guess, a screenshot of their comments with the so-called professor saying, you're the one that seems to be upset about something. Why don't you tell me? By the way, emojis don't support an argument. They just make you look like an idiotic preteen, just for your info.
That looks like a text from my 16-year-old niece when she's angry. But, wow, this character doesn't have very good views, does he? Anyways, let's move on to debunking Professor Dumb Dave's first challenge.
Hey everyone, so it's been almost exactly 1 year since I published my innocuous little Flat Earth debunk as part of my astronomy series. This time I'd like to offer some challenges to you remaining few that are desperately clinging to this dying fad to derive some semblance of self-worth. Let's call them
10 Challenges for Flat Earthers.
These will be some basic things that anyone could do to test the validity of the Flat Earth hypothesis. These are so mind-numbingly obvious that the fact that you don't do them is an immediate indicator of your complete lack of intellectual integrity.
Okay, the first thing I notice about this guy is he sounds like a little spoiled teenage girl who thinks she already knows everything. Not to mention the fact that he is in a bedroom with the door closed and an entertainment center in the background, a poster of a rock band on the wall, and a keyboard on a table. Once again, reminds me of a teenager.
Let's get started and you'll see what I mean. Number one, here's the Flat Earth map that you all seem to agree upon. Anyone with half a brain can immediately tell that this does not correlate with reality, but for those with an even smaller fraction, let's do a few things to prove it. For example, make a scale. You know, a scale. It's that thing on maps that tells you how far away things are from each other.
Okay, he says this is the Flat Earth map that everyone agrees upon. And then says anyone with half of a brain can tell that this doesn't correlate with reality. So, let's just take a look and see who correlates with this map being reality. Okay, here's the Hammond's Air Age map from 1943. All those little red lines you see are all the flight patterns from 1943. And here we have the American School of the Air map from 1947. All those little red lines are all the flight patterns from that year. And here we have another Air Age map with the flight patterns on it from 1950. And here we have the United Nations logo with the same map. And here we have the UN flag with the same map. And here we have the United Nations General Assembly Hall with the same map on the wall in the background. And the Meteorological Organization, International Maritime Organization, even the World Health Organization, they all have this map in their logo. And I could go on and on, but the point is, all these organizations and government agencies seem to correlate with this map as reality. And I would say that we all agree that these agencies and organizations are a lot smarter and a lot more important than this guy. And that alone debunks his comment of the map correlating with reality. Now let's move on.
For example, make a scale. You know, a scale? It's that thing on maps that tells you how far away things are from each other. Look at this map. There's a scale. You can pick two cities and determine the approximate distance between them. Then you can drive your car from one to another and verify that it is the correct distance. Now back to your little map.
Okay, now he's talking about using a scale on a real map for distances. Now, any professor knows that any world map is not correct at all. For instance, check this out.
You're telling me that Germany isn't where we think it is?
Nothing's where you think it is.
That's because maps are lying to you.
Are you saying the map is wrong?
Oh dear, yes.
It's just a common belief that maps are absolute, conclusive, and indisputable.
People tend to believe maps because by and large they work for them. They are accepted as fact.
We see over time, we start to accept as true, even though it might not really be true, or it's just a representation of the Earth.
There is, of course, the possibility that the information on a map, you know, might be fudged. That has happened.
Generation after generation of cartographers have designed maps presenting the world as something it's not. In fact, some cartographers have used maps as tools of propaganda. Not all maps, however, were created to steal land or to control an industry.
The German cartographer, Mercator, originally designed this map in 1569 as a navigational tool for European sailors.
The map enlarges areas at the poles to create straight lines of constant bearing or geographic direction.
But why would seemingly loyal and dutiful maps want to betray us? It all comes down to dimensions. A three-dimensional globe cannot accurately be portrayed by a rectangular two-dimensional map. In other words, you can't square a circle.
Geographers have always struggled with the challenge of representing our spherical world on a flat paper. So you can't wrap a globe in paper because you get wrinkles and overlap, and it just doesn't work right.
But every projection you make, I would suggest you replace the word projection with the word distortion, because that's what it is. You're distorting everything.
Mercator projection has fostered European imperialist attitudes for centuries and created an ethnic bias against the Third World.
And so the whole world was Eurocentric, became Eurocentric focused in a way at that time. And so we've just continued with those representations.
Map makers continue to take liberties today. Just ask New Zealand.
The next great conspiracy. New Zealand is disappearing off world maps.
It may be silly, but New Zealand spearheaded a tourism campaign to have the country return to world maps. Turns out, cartographers and artists around the globe had made a practice of excluding it.
New Zealand, where the bloody hell are you?
Seemingly germane, the practice appears to have created a crisis within New Zealand's national psyche. There are entire groups dedicated to calling out these oversights, not to mention similar groups for Madagascar, Denmark, and the Caribbean.
So, like I said, any professor knows that world maps are wrong. I mean, even 8-year-old kids know this.
The world map is wrong.
Okay, so we've either established that this guy is lying to you by telling you to use a world map, which is not correct in the first place, or he's just dumb enough that he doesn't know that. Anyways, let's move on.
Where's the scale here? Why do you never include one? Is it because it's impossible? Yes, that is exactly why. And if you disagree, here's your challenge. Pick some distance on this map. A centimeter, an inch, whatever. Tell me the distance it corresponds to in reality. Then pick some cities and use your scale to estimate the distances between them. Pick two on the same continent. Pick two on different continents. Use it to tell me how wide this inappropriately enormous ocean is. Use it to tell me literally anything about the distances between literally anything. When you can't do it and your numbers do not correlate with reality in the slightest, recall that this map does it just fine, and then admit that your map is stupid.
Okay, once again, we have the little angry teenage girl. Just admit that your map is stupid. Not to mention the fact that he's trying to deceive you by showing you a computer-generated image of a flat earth map instead of a real flat earth map. And take a listen to what he said here.
Where's the scale here? Why do you never include one? Is it because it's impossible?
No, dumb Dave. It's not because it's impossible. It's because you are showing a computer-generated image of a flat earth map instead of a real flat earth map, which does have a scale on it, as you can see here. With the Gleason's New Standard Map of the World, 1892, which says scientifically and practically correct as it is. But if you'll go right down here to the bottom of the map right here, you see what this is right here? This is called a scale. Okay, this is how you measure distance, dumb Dave. Now, when he tells you guys this, he knows you're not going to investigate it. That's why he's getting away with telling you this. But as you can see here, the upper portion of this scale shows the relations that English or land miles sustain to nautical or sea miles, sometimes called geographical. The lower half shows minutes and degrees of the arc as compared to sun time by laying a straight edge across the scale. It shows the relations of all the divisions. Now, what's that say right there, dumb Dave? Says scale. Okay, so quit telling people that flat earth maps do not have a scale. Now, being that you know this map has a scale, you go buy this map. and you cut the scales out and pin them in the middle and measure any distance you want to on this flat earth map, and you will debunk your own challenge. And you can learn how to use it like real professors, navigators, and scientists learned to do in 1892 with this map. Anyways, let's let Dumb Dave finish what he's got to say about his challenge number one.
Your complete inability to make any kind of remotely legitimate map single-handedly proves the Earth isn't flat. But let's continue just for fun. Number two.
Okay, let me hear that part one more time.
Your complete inability to make any kind of remotely legitimate map single-handedly proves the Earth isn't flat. But let's continue just for fun.
Okay, let's finish debunking the rest of his first challenge, which is he's stating here there is no legit flat earth map, which means the earth is not flat. But Dumb Dave, I just showed you a real flat earth map. Now let me prove it to you. Okay, as you can see, this is the Gleason's new standard map of the world. It says scientifically and practically correct as it is. Nowhere on this map does it say that this is a projection map of a globe. But you know what it does say? It says new standard map of the world on the projection of J.S. Christopher, Modern College, Blackheath, England. Now let's go to the University of Milwaukee. Here we are, Gleason's new standard map of the world. And there's an image of the map, but let's go down here below that. Now right down here under item description, full title, Gleason's new standard map of the world on the projection of J.S. Christopher, Modern College, Blackheath, England, scientifically and practically correct as it is. Short title, Flat Earth, 1892-2013. Now, being that this specific map that I have is from the Boston Public Library, let's go to Boston's Rare Maps and see what they say about Gleason himself and J.S. Christopher, the man who made the map. Okay, extraordinary rare 1892 Flat Earth map by Alexander Gleason. Now, let's stroll down here and see what we got going on. Oh, there's your scale, Dumb Dave. Even Google shows you how to use the scale on the Flat Earth map. Now, this is just a description of the map, which is on the map. We want to know the details behind the map, the story behind the map. So, like I was saying, as we stroll past the description of the map, what we want to do is go down here. Let me show you here. It says, things get weird, though, with the description key on the back of the map, which ends with the sentence, the demonstration has reference to either considerations, the Earth a globe or a plane. Take your choice. To make sense of all this, one must refer to Gleason. Is the Bible from heaven? Is the Earth a globe? Buffalo Electrotype and Engraving Company, 1890, with an enlarged second edition in 1893. There, he marshals scripture, quirkly interpretations of physical science, shoddy observation, and dollops of common sense to argue that the Earth is flat, stationary, and the center of the cosmos. Late in the work, he announces and describes his new map, which is the one that I just showed you guys at the beginning of the video. And here he's just explaining the colors of the map, what all it contains, the continents, the islands, the rivers, and whatnot. But what we want to do is stroll down to here. And it says, in any event, he presumably chose not to mention his flat earth views in the application in order to avoid the risk of rejection by the patent office. Okay, so now here we have Alexander Gleason. Let's stroll down the page here. Okay, Alexander Gleason, November 28th, 1827. To March 13, 1909, was an American machinist and civil engineer, a proponent in his later years of flat earth theory, and in particular noted for his new standard map of the world, 1892, the one that we are speaking of, the one that I just showed you. Okay, now let's stroll down here a little further to the press coverage and see what it says. Okay, Buffalo and the Earth. An intelligent journal says the world is our oyster. Buffalo Commercial, Buffalo, New York, 7/21, November 1890. Is it any wonder that Alexander Gleason of number 1201 Niagara Street is making an effort to prove that the Earth is flat. Nowadays, nothing seems impossible to a Buffalonian. When Mr. Gleason has successfully demonstrated his theory in regard to our planet, he will doubtless take possession of the Earth in the name of his native city. There was a time when Chicago waved the palm for greatest exhibition and municipal claims. The tide of empire, however, has begun to set eastward. Buffalo, the world is yours. Zetetic and theoretic defined. Buffalo Commercial, Buffalo, New York, 624 March 1893. Again, there has arisen in our midst with bold attack upon the present system of astronomy and geodesy, a work of surpassing magnitude by one Alexander Gleason of our own city, published by the Buffalo Electrotype and Engraving Company, and for sale by either of the above name. The work referred to bears of the title, Is the Bible from Heaven? Is the Earth a Globe? While it is manifest from a moment's glance that to the first interrogation, there is no doubt in the mind of the writer as to the inspiration of the word. In regard to the second, if the diagrams and statistical measurements are correct, there remains some hard-shelled nuts for our scientists to crack. So, people, as you can see, Alexander Gleason was a flat earther, and without a shadow of a doubt, this is his flat earth map, and I just gave you the history of the flat earth map and Mr. Gleason. Now let's move on to J.S. Christopher. The subtitle of Gleason's map credits the projection to J.S. Christopher of Modern College Blackheath. Okay, now let's scroll down and see about Christopher. It says he was born 1805 in Dartmouth, Devon, was a merchant active in the East, blah, 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 blah. Now, at some time in life, Christopher got hooked on Samuel Burley Robotham's Zetetic Astronomy. Now, if you're not familiar with who Samuel Burley Robotham is, he wrote a book in 1864 called Earth Not a Globe. Both Zetetic Astronomy and Christopher's map made their way across the Atlantic and found inheritance here in the United States. Alexander Gleason among them. Somehow Gleason got hold of Christopher's map and republished it. Not once, but twice. And if you look a little further down, it says Gleason's 1885 flat earth map is so rare that only images I find are reproductions, such as this one on eBay. His second map of 1892 offered here is almost equally rare. So now that we have established that this is a map of a flat earth, through detailed research that I just showed you and showed you how Alexander Gleason and J.S. Christopher are both flat earthers. And this is their flat earth map. And even the pretty lady here on the news will tell you it's not a projection map of the globe. It's a flat earth map with the North Pole in the center and the ice walls holding everything in. Check it out.
The curving horizon, the sloping sea level, the spin of the Earth. Unless you can see these phenomena with your own eyes, they may not be true. Unlike what we've been told in school, the Earth looks like a snow globe, round but not sphere. The North Pole is at the center of most flat Earth maps, with the ice of Antarctica holding everything in.
You see, even the news lady knows that this is a flat earth map. Anyways, we have debunked Professor Dumb Dave's number one challenge. Therefore, that completes this episode of Debunking Professor Dumb Dave. So everyone be sure to join me in episode 2, where we debunk his number 2 challenge. Everyone, thanks for watching. Have a good night and God bless.
All I'm offering is the truth. Nothing more. All I'm offering is the truth. Nothing more.
Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to episode 2 of Debunking Professor Dumb Dave. Now, if you recall, in episode 1, I went on to Professor Dumb Dave's Facebook and took a look at his reviews. Well, I went back there today and he only has two more reviews. So let's check those out real quick before we start debunking his number two challenge. The first thing I noticed was he went from 3.8 stars to 3.7. Anyways, this was an hour ago. We have Chloe Marie. And Chloe says, only knows how to insult, incapable of civil debate. Okay, let's go into the comments of Chloe's review. Okay, we have Professor Dumb Dave commenting on Chloe's review. And he says, man, the whiny trolls are really active today. I'm sorry that I showed you how stupid your worldview is. Maybe cry more about it privately instead of having tantrums online. And then Chloe says, way to prove my point. Thanks. Okay, let's go and check the other review from 7 hours ago from Irina Lee. Terrible impression. I watched his debates with other people. He acts arrogantly and very disrespectful. Okay, now let's go into the comments on Irina's review. Okay, we have Professor Dumb Dave lashing back at the review with, and the con men who lie for a living that I expose and deplatform as a public service. They're perfect angels. Yeah, get your priorities together, kiddo. And Irina says, my point is that acting aggressively towards opponents doesn't help to convince you are right. It actually has the opposite effect. And then she says, why not to be just more open-minded and flexible? You are just a human. You can make mistakes too, as we all of course. Why simply not to look at your theory critically and try to understand that if so many people all over the world still don't accept it, in spite of all the proofs that nothing created everything, there must be some serious reasons. Aggression and arrogance will not really help here. It plays against you as a scientist. And he lashes back with, the Earth is objectively a sphere. Stop whining about open-minded and admit that you fell for the dumbest hoax on the entire internet. Cry more about it. And she says, same thing for you. Darwin theory of nothing created everything is relatively young, less than 200 years, and you also fell for this dumbest hoax. I am using your vocabulary here, and you crying about it online, trying to convince everyone around in your beliefs. You see, when you point a finger at someone, three fingers are pointing back at you. And then she says, you can use whatever sophisticated or scientific terms you want to proof your beliefs and theories, but it doesn't change the true meaning of your beliefs. Nothing created everything. So intelligently, so beautifully, so aesthetically, all praise to God for his creation. And of course, Professor Dumb Dave never answered Irina back after that. Good job, Irina. You must have touched a nerve and hurt his little self-centered feelings. Good job. Well, I have to say, I think we all understand why this guy doesn't have a job as a professor teaching at a university anywhere. Just by the comments alone, you can tell this guy has a mental illness called cognitive dissonance. So let's help Professor Dumb Dave understand what that is. Cognitive dissonance, the mental conflict that occurs when beliefs or assumptions are contradicted by new information. The unease or tension that the conflict arouses in people is relieved by one of several defensive maneuvers. They reject, explain away, or avoid the new information, persuade themselves that no conflict really exists, reconcile the differences, or resort to any other defensive means of preserving stability or order in their conceptions of the world and of themselves. Now that wraps Professor Dumb Dave up in a nutshell there. Anyways, let's move on. Now another thing I'm going to do in this episode is let Professor Dumb Dave explain to you his educational background. Here we go.
And today I want to address another question that I get very frequently in regards to my career background and educational background. A lot of you want to know where I went to school and what I studied. And a lot of you want to know if I currently teach in the flesh, and if so, where. And furthermore, a lot of you ask very incredulously, are you a real professor?
So I wanted to knock out all of these all at once and just sort of give you a quick summary of my my life and career since college. I went to Minnesota for college. I went to a liberal arts school called Carleton College, which is a really great place. And while I was there, I got a bachelor's degree in chemistry. So here's me looking real tough in the cold, cold winter. And immediately after that, I went over to California. I went to UC Santa Cruz to do a master's program in synthetic organic chemistry. But I didn't really last long. I dropped out in my second semester. I wanted to move up to San Francisco and play music. So I was there a couple years playing in some different bands. And then I moved down to Los Angeles, again, for music opportunities. And but I eventually got this teaching job for organic chemistry at this little trade university here in the LA area. They offered me the job permanently, but contingent on me getting a master's at the same time. So I went over to Cal State Northridge to give a second shot at a master's degree in chemistry. And I did that for a few years. I was researching and studying over at CSUN and all the while teaching this organic chemistry course. But through a bunch of bureaucracy, quite frankly, I lost that job and along with it, the funding for my master's program. So I had to withdraw yet again from the master's program. I lost that job. And along with the funding for my master's program, so I had to withdraw yet again from the master's program. And but I didn't want these lectures to evaporate into the ether. I wanted them to remain in some tangible form, even if I wasn't going to be teaching there anymore. So I decided to record them to camera. Just as I would be speaking to my class, and put them online, and that was the birth of Professor Dave Explains. And I chose the name really without much thought. It was kind of tongue-in-cheek, to be honest. I just thought it'd be fun to have like a little persona. You know, Professor Dave, it's just, you know, a little name. And I'm back in school for a third attempt at a master's degree. This time in science education, so it's a little bit different. And I'll be done in the spring. But to be honest, I really don't have any desire to go back to teaching after that because I'm doing this full time. I sit literally in this room like 60 to 70 hours a week. I sit literally in this room
holy jumping fucking shitballs. Dumber than a second coat of paint.
Well, imagine that. Here we have a guy who labeled himself a professor who dropped out of college because he couldn't complete his master's and became a musician and then gets a job teaching chemistry. And in order to keep that job, he has to complete his master's, which again, he fails to do and loses his job because he can't complete his master's. And who is now trying to complete his master's for a third time, sitting in an isolated bedroom at his parents' house 60 to 70 hours a week, proclaiming to be a professor with only a degree in chemistry. So I honestly don't even see the point in going on and debunking his teenage challenges, but I'm going to now just for the fun of it. So let's move on with debunking Professor Dumb Dave's number two challenge.
This time I'd like to offer some challenges to you remaining few that are desperately clinging to this dying fad to derive some semblance of self-worth. Let's call them
10 challenges for flat earthers.
These will be some basic things that anyone could do to test the validity of the flat earth hypothesis. These are so mind-numbingly obvious that the fact that you don't do them is an immediate indicator of your complete lack of intellectual integrity. Let's get started and you'll see what I mean.
Number two, as we all know, the existence of Antarctica poses a huge problem for you. When it is summer in the northern hemisphere, you love to pretend that the sun moves inwards to this tropic, making the days longer here and shorter in the southern hemisphere. And then when it's winter in the north, you like to put the sun at the other tropic, which you think gives you the shorter days up north that you want, but in the south, it's total chaos.
Okay, let's debunk this part of the challenge real quick. Professor Dumb Dave says, we like to pretend that the sun moves inward in the summer solstice and moves outward in the winter solstice. No, Dumb Dave, we don't like to pretend that. This knowledge goes all the way back to the ancient Egyptians, the ancient Mayans, the ancient Incas, and even the 1892 Gleason's Flat Earth map explains that to you right down there at the bottom of the map where you claim there wasn't a scale at, which I showed you in episode one. So let's get you educated real quick on the summer solstice and the winter solstice from the 1892 Gleason's map once again. So let's look down here at the bottom left of the map at the summer solstice. In the figures, June and December, the white represents the sun's position in his respective months. At noon, this shows sunlight inside the Arctic Circle for 24 hours. From June 21st, the sun moves around the tropics in a spiral circle, widening every day until it reaches its destiny on the southern or outer solstice on December 21st. And it even shows you a diagram right here, plain to see. The North Pole right there in the middle. See that little dot right there? That's the sun. See the illumination around that dot? That's telling you the small circle that it makes in the summer solstice, all the while widening every day. Okay, now over here to the bottom right of the map, you have the winter, December solstice. On December the 21st, the sun moves around the Tropic of Capricorn, and during the day lights up the southern portion of the Earth from the Arctic Circle to some portion of Antarctica ice. There is no sunlight beyond 80 degrees south, but unknown regions of ice. On the 23rd of December, the sun commences his northward journey again, returning to his starting place, and thus completes his seasons. And you have a diagram right above that showing you there's the North Pole, there's the sun, making its wide circuit around the flat Earth. So therefore, that debunks your comment about we pretend that this is what the sun does. No, Dumb Dave, this scientific map tells you the movement of the sun. And not only that, this map also makes you look dumb when you say this is a projection map of a globe. If it was a projection map of a globe, it wouldn't tell you that the sun moves inward in the summer solstice and that the sun moves outward in the winter solstice. Now let's move on.
You have the sun tracing this enormous trajectory, which would leave everything out here in darkness for most of the day, when in reality, there are long periods of time in Antarctica where the sun never sets. Since your dinky little sun can never illuminate this entire fantasy ice wall at once, this completely obliterates your model, which is why you resort to conspiracy. You simply deny that this midnight sun ever occurs.
Okay, once again, Dumb Dave, we don't have to resort to conspiracy theories. We can just resort to the scientific map, which says right here, there is no sunlight beyond 80 degrees south, but unknown regions of ice. If you would do a little bit of research, you would understand this, being that you spend 60 to 70 hours a week in that bedroom, then you've got plenty of time for me to educate you. Let's move on.
You have the sun tracing this enormous trajectory, which would leave everything out here in darkness for most of the day.
Okay, let me correct you there, Dumb Dave. Not most of the day, but for over 4 months, there is total darkness there. And I'll let the people who actually are stationed in Antarctica explain that to you.
He spent countless hours standing in the freezing cold in an effort to capture the true feeling of this vast, important place. There really are only two seasons in Antarctica. A busy summer when most of the science happens, and a wild and lonely winter that few people will ever experience. In the middle of March, there's that magical brief couple of weeks when the sun is rising and setting like normal days, and you can actually leave the curtains open on your window at night to be woken up by the sunrise in the morning.
How are your parents?
Another hour? Are we ever going to see the sun again?
One day.
To get used to living in a world without light. The days get short and the nights get long, till the nights get real long. There's no more sun, and that's all she wrote.
I was scared of the coming darkness, for so many months. And I thought, is that going to get to me? Is that going to make me, well, how will that affect me? I was pretty scared of that and how that might just change me.
You know, when you watch television here and you see all the things that are going wrong in the world, you know, it's like, thank goodness I'm here. But then you also then watch shows where you see swaying palm trees and people laughing and bucolic scenes, and you're not there. You're here where it's dark and cold and windy.
It's the month of June, and right now it's the middle of the day.
I loved the 24 hours of darkness. Maybe on full moon nights and other nights I would see the mountains, but sometimes I'd forget the mountains were even there. And so my entire world was just in the little spaces and, you know, walking around.
So as you can see, Professor Dumdan,
it really does change your perception.
So as you can see, Professor Dumdave, from the people who are actually stationed there, there is no sunlight there for over 4 months in the winter.
You have the sun tracing this enormous trajectory, which would leave everything out here in darkness for most of the day, when in reality, there are long periods of time in Antarctica where the sun never sets.
Holy jumping fucking shitballs. Dumber than a second coat of paint.
While claiming that no one can go to Antarctica to verify it for themselves, because the government NASA Jew penguins will kill you. Well, apart from all the commercial cruises, civilians can even apply for jobs there, so you totally could go see it for yourself.
Okay, now, Professor Dumdave is kind of correct on this matter right here. You can go there, you can get a job there, but not your average person. You either have to be an engineer, a scientist, a mechanic, someone with a very high skill of profession. And even those people just can't wander off and do what they want to. They're kind of like prisoners there. They're stationed at a base, and that's where they remain until it's time to leave. And I'll let them explain that to you themselves.
I saw Erebus and wanted to go hiking there and snowboard down it, and I was quickly told no, and then I was off to work, yeah.
We had been thinking, oh, we're going to Antarctica, and then when you get here, it's like, oh yeah, I've got to work. And you don't put that into your head your first time. You're so excited about coming down that you forget that you're coming down here for a reason. They hurried us off the plane so we couldn't take a look around, and pretty much it was just here, and the next thing we knew, we were in town. So the first thing we really saw of Antarctica was McMurdo, and that's always kind of disappointing sometimes.
I've seen a lot of different personalities come down here. The ones that seem to do the most of it are the diehards or the more grounded people.
McMurdo Station sits beside the sea on Ross Island. It's dwarfed by Mount Erebus, the southernmost active volcano in the world. 3 kilometers away on the other side of the peninsula is the small New Zealand outpost, Scott Base. Scott Base is a lot more typical in size of the other bases dotted around Antarctica. And its proximity to McMurdo is unusual.
At Scott Base, you have to live and work in one building. Our accommodation is a very small room. It's like a cell, if you like, or a cupboard. A lot of things here can get to you pretty quickly, especially in winter. And you cannot change them. You cannot argue much about them either, because this person will be in front of your eyes, you know, on the next smoker. So to be tolerant is very important.
I could live indefinitely here if I could, on occasion, get out. Like, I haven't, I've literally gone nowhere since August.
You will get to see some fun stuff, but the main thing you're down here for is to work. And I hate to sound cold when it comes to that, but I think a lot of people lose that focus. And when they come down here and all they get to see is a dish room or get to stare at a computer the whole time, I think they might be a little disillusioned.
We're in a box, and there's no escape from each other. You can't get away. You're forced to interact day in and day out, and you get to know people very, very quickly. Whether those relationships be good or bad, they're going to be very, very intense.
But most people are thinking about heading home. When the last plane leaves, that's it. You're stuck here for the next 6 months. No way out.
So, as you can see, you're not just allowed to roam free wherever you want to. You are to stay where you are stationed at that base. And also remembering that the only way in and the only way out is by Air Force plane, where you are guarded the whole time. And therefore, totally debunking everything that Professor Dumdave was babbling on about. Okay, now let's wrap this up.
Just look up times of sunrise and sunset on the internet. In mid-December, sunrise is earlier than 5 a.m., and sunset is later than 10 p.m. Now take your little model for the seasons and make it show night and day. Then try and make the night and day portions match up with these sunrise and sunset times. Demonstrate the light from the sun illuminating this location for more than 70% of its trajectory. And as you do that, make sure that it does not illuminate Point Barrow, Alaska whatsoever during its entire trajectory, as that town has endless night during this time of the year. That's right, lots of sun over here and zero sun over here. Good luck. If you decide to even try, observe that the light patterns become so nonsensical that not even the most meth-fueled creatives amongst you could vomit enough magnetism jargon to justify it. If you can't make your model show the seasons and night and day at the same time, as I pointed out that you can't almost a year ago, then seriously consider shutting up forever.
Oh, so now he's back into sounding like a teenage girl going into puberty. I thought we already debunked this with the Antarctica video alone, but just for fun, let's go ahead and debunk this idiotic part of the challenge also.
See this white dot in the middle with the end in it? That's the North Pole. The little black dot is the sun. It shows you its pattern, which is a small circle, and it even tells you down here in the June solstice. In the figures, June and December, the white represents the sun's position in his respective months at noon. This shows sunlight inside the Arctic Circle for 24 hours. From June 21st, the sun moves around the tropic in a spiral circle, widening every day until it reaches its destiny at the southern or outer solstice on December 21st. Okay, now, what that means is, in the summertime, it's making a small circle, a small spiral circle, just like it showed you in the diagram right above the paragraph that you read. And it widens every day, which means it starts to go out, which that's why it starts to get cold. It's starting to move out and away from you. And then we go to the December solstice, the winter solstice, December 21st. Now, notice how the sun is out wide from the North Pole. It's making a wide spiral circle from this close spiral circle, as you see here. Now, let's look down underneath the diagram of the map and see what it tells us for December solstice. Okay, on December the 21st, the sun moves around the Tropic of Capricorn, and during the daylight up the southern portion of the Earth from the Arctic Circle to some portion of Antarctica ice. There is no sunlight beyond 80 degrees south, but unknown regions of ice. And on the 23rd of December, the sun commences his northward journey again, returning to his starting place, and thus completes his seasons.
Okay, now as you can see, even the map itself tells you that the sun rotates, not the earth. Now let's move on.
Your December solstice would look like this right here on the flat earth map. It's way out here, check it out. Dark on one side of the earth, light on the other, just so you understand that. It makes a wide circle, right like this right here. That's why it's cold right here. It's cold right there in the United States in the wintertime, isn't it? Because the sun's way out here. Sun's way out here. And then in the spring, what's the sun start doing? It starts moving in closer. That's why your days start getting longer. And it starts getting warmer. And then by the summer solstice, as you see right here, it says it spirals in to the Arctic Circle. There's your Arctic Circle right there. So this right here is your North Pole. And this little spot right here, this is Alaska. Now in the summer solstice, here's where the sun is. Well, check out what's getting 24 hours of daylight. The Arctic, the North Pole. Because see, the sun's making a small circle. That's why daytime is longer in the summertime right here in the United States, because it doesn't take the sun very long to come back around. That's why you have short nights and long days. And then as the sun starts to go back out
to its winter solstice, what to start doing? Nights start getting longer and the days get shorter and starts getting cooler and colder, right? Until the sun goes all the way back out to the ice. And then it's cold again. I mean, this is a no-brainer. Why do you think birds fly south for winter? Why do you think fish in the sea migrate south for the winter? Because they're following the sun out. And when the sun comes back in, they migrate back north because they're following the sun back in. That'd be impossible on a spinning ball with the sun 93 million miles away. They follow the sun out and they follow it in. You can't follow the sun if it's way out in outer space. And the seasons prove that also. That's why when the sun's moving in, all the vegetation starts coming back to life, right? And then as it moves back out in the fall, everything starts dying again because it lives off of that sun. And if it were 93 million miles away, it would be impossible for that to happen. And there's nothing 80 degrees south. No sunlight, nothing there past 80 degrees south. Because that's nothing but unknown regions of ice, just like the map told you. Totally debunking and destroying Professor Dumdave's number two challenge. And therefore, that completes this episode of Debunking Professor Dumdave. So, everyone, be sure to join me in episode 3, where we debunk his number 3 challenge. Everyone have a good night. Thanks for watching, and God bless.
All I'm offering is the truth. Nothing more. All I'm offering is the truth. Nothing more.
Good evening, everyone, and welcome to episode 3 of Debunking Professor Dumdave. Now, as you guys know by now, I love to start the episode out with going over Professor Dumdave's reviews for the day. Now, in episode 1, he had a 3.8 star rating. And in episode 2, he had a 3.7 star rating. And it looks like today he has a 3.5 star rating. Now that's awesome. It looks like everyone's starting to see this clown for the fraud that he is. Anyways, let's move on with his reviews for the day. Okay, here we have Dally from 4 hours ago, who says, this one right here is 100% deceiver to the masses. Don't trust this fool. Okay, here we have Scott from 11 hours ago, who says, insults and is paid by the elite to keep the lie going. And here we have Georgie, who says, because he's on paycheck for the lie agenda. Okay, and here we have Antoine, who says, this guy is not a real scientist. Total waste of time to even look at his page. He's here to distract and keep people dumbed down with lies. And I would agree with you on that, Antoine. Let's take a look at the comments on that one. Okay, we have Dumb Dave answering back saying, man, the trolls are really out today. What's the agenda? Dumb which lies? The lies I debunked that you fail for? Pathetic. Then we have Georgie's comment, which is hidden because it might be offensive. Let's unhide it. Hey, idiot monkeys professor, soon you're going to have to close this idiot page. Imagine that. Georgie's comment is hidden because it says idiot monkeys, but Professor Dumb Dave's comment is not hidden, and he's actually using the word dumb in it. Something awful fishy about that. Looks like he might be working for Facebook too. They're not hiding his comments. Anyways, let's go back to the reviews. Okay, here we have Michael, who says, I challenge you to debunk Terry R. Eicher videos. He made debunking your videos. I doubt you will, though. I'll be waiting for your excuses and or childish name calling and attitude. May the sphere be with you. Well, thanks, Michael. Okay, let's take a look in the comments and see if Professor Dumb Dave responded back to Michael. Okay, we have Professor Dumb Dave responding back with, I don't know who that is, and I guarantee that he's a moron. You are too for falling for the dumbest hoax on the entire internet. And Michael responds with, here he is, and we all know you won't bother. And then Michael goes on to send him links to my videos. And then Michael says, hey, Dave, why can't I click on your actual page? See, I knew you would do this. We all know you're a complete fake fraud. You show people your true colors. You are a deceiver and a liar. The truth is slowly coming out. Now, let's look back at what Professor Dumb Dave said about me. He says, I don't know who that is, but also in the same sentence, he calls me a moron. Well, thanks, Dumb Dave. And like I said before, we can tell why this clown is not teaching in some school or university. Look at his vocabulary reaction to the public reviews. Now, I don't know about the rest of you, but when I see Professor Dumb Dave responding in the comments, this is what I personally see.
You're crazy.
I know you are, but what am I?
You're a nerd.
I know you are, but what am I?
You're an idiot.
I know you are, but what am I?
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 I know you are, but what am I? Infinity.
Anyways, that's how I see him. So, hey, Professor Dumb Dave, let's get you introduced. I'm the moron who's debunking your Pee Wee Herman bullcrap. Now that you understand that, let's move on with debunking Professor Dumb Dave's number 3 challenge.
This time I'd like to offer some challenges to you remaining few that are desperately clinging to this dying fad.
Okay, did you hear what he just said?
To you remaining few that are desperately clinging to this dying fad.
To us remaining few who are desperately clinging on to this dying fad of flat earth. I just want to debunk that comment real quick before we move on.
The round or spherical earth theory is propagated by some conspiracy.
And the number of people who think so is growing. Thousands, if not millions of people, believe the world is flat.
And it's the subject of tonight's special report. WCIA3's Aaron Eads is here with us now. And Aaron, as far as conspiracy theories go, flat earth theory is actually getting pretty popular.
Yeah, believe it or not, the number of people who believe the earth is flat is actually growing. Scientists might have an idea of why that is, and it's worth talking about. And what better place to do so than one of the flattest places in the country, right here in central Illinois.
But there are ideas that this is a sham. NASA, a fraudulent organization bent on siphoning your tax dollars. The moon landing didn't happen.
Those iconic blue marble images seen from space, fakes.
You start seeing words like composite or animation or, you know, something that tells you this is not an actual photograph of the Earth.
The biggest concern with the flat Earth movement is how fast it's gaining steam. Scientists are worried that flat Earth could become a political issue like climate change, vaccination, or evolution. Guys.
All right. Fascinating stuff. All right, Aaron, thank you.
Very interesting.
Imagine that. I didn't even have to do anything. The mainstream media debunked that comment. I just had to clear that up real quick. Let's move on.
To derive some semblance of self-worth, let's call them
10 challenges for flat earthers.
Number 3, here's an idea. What if you were to actually make a prediction with your model? Like any prediction. You know, those things that you have to do in science for it to be science? Pick any celestial object, a planet, a comet, a star. Now pick any time in the future, and using only the flat earth model and nothing else, tell me where it will be at that time. If you can't do this, and I know you can't, consider admitting that your model is absolutely irrelevant. People who actually understand the geometry of the Earth and the solar system can predict a solar eclipse, specifying the start and end time down to the second and tracing its precise path down to the square mile. Doing that even a single time means the model used to make the prediction has been undeniably verified, and it's done every single time. Anyone who doesn't see the importance of that has no clue how science works.
Okay, now this would be Professor Dumb Dave's dumbest challenge, just because of the simple fact, I don't think Dumb Dave understands that we who live here on the real flat earth see the same sky, the same stars, the same sun and moon that he sees on his fake pretend spinning ball. So therefore, we would make those predictions the same way that you who live on your fake spinning ball would. For example, the Mayans, who were flat earthers, made eclipse predictions for 5,000 years before they even come up with the spinning globe bullcrap. Now, with today's technology, all you need to do is calculate the precise motions of the sun and moon, and all you need to do that with is a computer and the proper software. And now that's the easiest way, but if you want to predict eclipses on a flat earth the way the Mayans did, in order to do that, you have to understand that the sun must be crossing a node, and the moon must be crossing either the same node, which is a solar eclipse, or the other node, which is a lunar eclipse. And that means, of course, the solar eclipse can only occur when the moon is new, and the lunar eclipse can only occur when the moon is full. And this can only occur during the period of an eclipse season, which the sun is close to a node in the moon's orbit. Now, for solar eclipses, the eclipse season is usually about 32 days long, and any new moon in this period will produce a solar eclipse. But now for the lunar eclipse, the eclipse season is shorter, around 22 days, and any full moon in that period will be eclipsed. All you really have to know is when there's going to be a full moon and a new moon. That's the only time that these eclipses can take place. And that simply comes with studying the sky every day and night for about a year and writing everything down. Then come that next year, you'll know exactly when every eclipse is going to take place, the same way the Mayans did it 5,000 years ago on the flat earth that they lived on. It's really, really simple. And if you don't understand how to read the sun and the moon and the stars in the sky, all you got to do is probably go to Google and look here. How did the Mayans predict solar eclipses? The Mayans were a very advanced society, and they were able to predict solar eclipses by studying ancient texts and observing the sun. They also used calendars to predict events. Just like I told you, you write down a calendar for a whole year. You study that calendar. You study the movements of the sun and the moon, and you will be able to predict these eclipses the same way they did. For example, right here, according to ancient texts, the Mayans predicted solar eclipses thousands of years in advance. The Mayan believed that these events were a sign from the gods and were used for religious ceremonies. By studying the Mayan predictions, it is possible to better understand how they viewed the universe. Solar eclipses are still a source of mystery for many people today, but the Mayan knowledge provides an interesting perspective. By understanding this ancient culture, we can gain a greater appreciation for science and astronomy as well. The Mayans were able to predict solar eclipses by studying the movements of the sun and moon. By following these patterns, they were able to make accurate predictions about when an eclipse would occur. The Mayans calendar is a complex system of predicting astronomical events like solar eclipses. To calculate the date and time of an eclipse, the Mayans used a day cycle with day intervals. The Mayan were some of the first people to predict solar eclipses, and their methods were quite advanced for their time. The Mayan used a variety of astronomical observations to predict solar eclipses. So as you can see, for thousands of years, the Mayans predicted eclipses in the same way that I just told you how to predict eclipses on the flat earth in modern times. And don't get me wrong, it's not that easy. You have to write everything down on a calendar, and you have to keep track of the sun and moon daily. But once you do learn how to do that, it's really, really simple. That's why this is Dumb Dave's dumbest challenge, because like I said, whether you live on the real flat earth or the fake spinning ball, no matter which viewpoint, we all still see the same sky, the same stars, the same sun and moon, making those predictions accurate. And now, with that being said, we have debunked Professor Dumday's number 3 challenge. And therefore, that completes this episode of Debunking Professor Dumdave. So everyone, be sure to join me in episode 4, where we debunk his number 4 challenge. Until then, everyone, thanks for watching. Have a good night, and God bless.
All I'm offering is the truth. Nothing more. All I'm offering is the truth. Nothing more.
Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to Debunking Professor Dumdave, Episode 4. So as most of you know by now, we can't review Professor Dumdave's reviews because he has went into the settings and deactivated the reviews. So no one can see where his challenges are being debunked, and no one can see the comments where people are airing him out for the fraud that he is. But we are able to go into the comments section of his videos and leave comments there. But if we go down and take a look at the comments in his videos, you'll see that he is going into those comments and deleting the comments out that he doesn't want his viewers and followers to see. For example, right here, Chad makes a comment 5 hours ago saying, "Why would you delete my comment asking why you won't debate Witsit Gets It on a fair, neutral platform? Are you that scared of him?" And then we go to the next video and we have Chuck saying, "More like talk fraud, Professor Dumdave. Why did you block reviews rather than debunking flat out truth Terry R. Eicher's answers and debunks to your dumb debunk challenge? You're a flat out fraud. How much are you paying for your video scripts now, Dumdave?" For all that didn't know, Dumdave doesn't want conversation. He does not want to critically analyze the facts and respond to his challenge. He censored us. All he has are scripts and ad hominems. Dumdave is a really dumb know-nothing, and he has admitted that. Check out this proof that Dumdave is a shill and does not want the conversation. And then Chuck leaves a link to one of my videos debunking him. And right here we have Tony, who says he is a big child who got teased and bullied as he was a little slow in the head when he was in kindergarten. He is the same nowadays. He is annoying as your mother-in-law you love to hate. Okay, that's pretty much all we have on that because, of course, like everyone is saying, Professor Dumdave is deleting the comments out. He apparently just hasn't got to these 3 that I just read to you yet. But I'm sure he will as soon as he sees them. Come on now, Dumdave. Don't delete the comments. You're taking away our entertainment for the day. Oh, well, it was fun while it lasted. Anyways, let's move on to Debunking Professor Dumdave, Episode 4, Challenge Number 4.
This time I'd like to offer some challenges to you remaining few that are desperately clinging to this dying fad to derive some semblance of self-worth. Let's call them
10 challenges for flat earthers.
Number 4, after I demolished essentially all of your favorite talking points in my previous videos, you all now cling primarily to the classic "I shouldn't see this thing" argument. You love this one because you can lie about heights and distances, do incorrect math, and in general act incredulous without having to actually do any science. Well, every time you whine about this, the objects are always suspiciously close, such that you can fudge the numbers, and they're always over water, so you can lie about refractive effects to people who have no idea how refraction works. So try this one on for size. Show me a picture of something over land that's 1,000 miles away.
Okay, now he's just being exaggerative, because anybody with any common sense knows that nowhere on land are you going to take a picture that's 1,000 miles away, just for the simple fact that you would have trees or hills or buildings or landscape obstructing your view. So, Professor Dumb Dave is either lying to you or he is really just that dumb. I believe it to be a little bit of both. But, for instance, everyone knows that water always finds its level and water is always flat on top, whether it's in your toilet, the bathtub, a swimming pool, a mud puddle, a lake, a pond, a river, a canal, even down to a little glass of water that you're drinking. The water level at the top of the glass will always be flat and level, no matter what. So therefore, most experiments done with a telescope or a camera are done over water, because it's flat, level, and precisely accurate for camera and telescope views. So, since Professor Dumb Dave claims that our experiments are a bunch of lies, let's go into the history books and show Dumb Dave a real scientist performing these experiments. And we'll start with Samuel Rowbotham, who was an English inventor, writer, and utopian socialist who wrote Zetetic Astronomy, Earth Not a Globe, under the pseudonym Parallax. His work was originally published as a 16-page pamphlet in 1849 and later expanded into a book in 1865. Rowbotham's method, which he called Zetetic Astronomy, models the Earth as a flat disk centered at the North Pole and bounded along its perimeter by a wall of ice, with the sun, moon, planets, and stars moving only several thousand miles above the surface of Earth. Anyways, let's look at an old PBS educational documentary featuring Samuel Rowbotham's famous experiment.
It's a commonly held misconception that the Earth is a spherical object that revolves around the Sun. But the fact is, of course, that the Earth is a circular dish surrounded by a barrier of ice that explorers have been attempting to penetrate for centuries.
Samuel Burley Rowbotham, better known throughout the scientific community as Parallax. In 1881, he had published this book, Earth Not a Globe. Outlining dozens of experiments performed over many years, it quickly became the standard authority for anti-globularists. Perhaps the most significant experiments were those carried out on a canal known as the Old Bedford Level. Located in Cambridgeshire, England, the canal is perfectly straight over an uninterrupted 6-mile stretch. While there, Parallax conducted many experiments, all towards one conclusion, to prove that the surface of the water in the canal was indeed perfectly flat. In one experiment, a boat carrying a flag rowed from one bridge to another 6 miles away. An observer with a telescope placed 8 inches above the surface of the water found that the flag and the boat were distinctly visible throughout the entire distance. If the Earth is a sphere with a circumference of 25,000 miles, then over a distance of 6 miles, the second bridge should mathematically be 16 feet below the observer's eye line.
Now, you can say what you want, Dumb Dave, but this historical experiment alone proves you to either be a liar or just dumb. Therefore, debunking the first part of your challenge. Now let's move on.
So try this one on for size. Show me a picture of something over land that's 1,000 miles away. May I suggest the middle of the country where there's not much in the way? It's a straight shot after all, so what's the problem? Use a telescope. Pull Las Vegas into focus from Dallas, Texas. Isn't that where you have your little meeting? Maybe you should try doing something productive rather than blindly perpetuating the dumbest hoax on the internet.
Okay, like I stated earlier, he's just being exaggerative and dumb right here, because anybody with a little bit of common sense knows that you're not going to be able to take a picture on land of something 1,000 miles away due to the fact of trees or mountains or hills or landscapes obstructing your view. But, however, you can take a picture of something 1,000 miles away if you're elevated high enough to look over the trees and hills and landscape. So, Professor Dumdave suggested that we show him a picture of something 1,000 miles away over land. Okay, here's an infrared picture taken by J. Tolan Media One. And what they do is they specialize in filming and taking pictures with infrared cameras, because the infrared takes out all the haze in the atmosphere, which distorts your view. Anyways, this picture was taken from a plane that was just taking off over Lake Michigan at 1,800 feet in altitude. And 1,000 miles out over the horizon, you can see the Rocky Mountains. Now, just in case Professor Dumdave says that's not 1,000 miles away, let's take a look here on Google Maps. So let me zoom this in so everyone can see this. And as you can see, it's actually 1,006.78 miles from Lake Michigan. So, anyways, there's your picture. And just in case you think that's impossible, I'll let J. Tolan Media One show you how it's done.
This is my infrared filter. It's a 950 nanometer long pass infrared filter. Blocks visible and lets infrared through, basically. I'll be putting that on the front of the camera, and then I'll switch the camera to night shot mode. You'll be amazed, Justin. Wow, look at that. Isn't that incredible? This green tint is default, and I cannot change it in Photoshop or actually Premiere. Adobe Premiere, I'll be changing it. So this looks much better. It desaturated the clip and adjusting contrast. And you'll see me adjusting contrast throughout the clips.
These guys film throughout the whole flight, so I'm going to time-lapse it just so we can move on. And if you guys want to watch the full video, I'll leave the link to their website in the description.
Because when we look down, it appears we're in a flat world. Everybody's got to make up their own mind. This is strange.
As you can see, these guys are really good at what they do. And as you could see with your own eyes, it's flat as a pancake, and you can see everything in detail with the infrared. So this debunks the 1,000-mile-away picture part of the challenge. Now let's do one at ground level across land. And this one comes to you from Super Zoom Videos. And this guy is doing this for the Guinness Book of World Records.
The video and audio that you're watching right now is being filmed from 12.4 miles away, or about 20,000 meters, which makes this the longest, furthest recorded video ever.
This is the 2-foot-long lens which is going to make this possible. It's one of the longest and most efficient lenses which can allow you to shoot extremely long distances. I have no idea why anyone would actually want to have this in real life. It is a 452 times zoom, which is, well, stupid. We're going to be able to see from one end of this extremely long desert road which stretches across this giant valley for about 12 miles. I'm going to be standing all the way on the other end of that, and then we're going to have this camera fastened safe and sound right here at this little clear out here, far away from the road, but still aimed at the exact other end of it. As you can see from the final result, this is how it looks like to be filmed from 12 miles away.
So I'm petitioning Guinness World Records, I'm looking right at you, Guinness, wherever you are, to basically allow me to gain this world record. And I'm going to explain to you how exactly I did that.
This thing right here is an apparatus which is going to prevent too much sunlight from reaching into the lens, because of course when you have a 400 plus x zoom and you're filming something from nearly 13 miles away, it's going to be kind of catastrophic to the end result. If too much sunlight is entering in there, it's going to overexpose extremely high.
This is the only valley in the entire country which just simply has the largest amount of open space that allows me to even attempt to do this. I really have no idea how it's going to turn out. So if you're seeing the video edited into this, that means it turned out actually good enough for me to make it into a YouTube video. I can only dearly hope that I'm actually standing in the right place to have myself filmed in, because from across this 12-mile wide valley where I have this whole camera set up and where I'm standing at the highway at the edge of the valley, the margin of error that I have in order to stand in the right place is equivalent to about 0.001 arc seconds. To put it simply, it's very, very narrow. The chances of me standing in the exact correct spot for you to see me is about the same chance of you getting a hole-in-one in Wii Sports Golf. And the chances of me looking directly at you right now is about the same chance as you getting a hole-in-one in Wii Sports Golf about 10 times in a row.
And also, as a further note that I forgot to add into this while I was recording, this was actually a 10 times further of a zoom than what the lens can offer on its own by using an updated version of the normal Canon DSLR's camera software, which allowed me to zoom in up to 10 times the distance as well that was already there, which made it technically over a 4,000x zoom.
Now, since we're here and I already traveled for about 45 minutes to get to the point away from where the camera is currently filming me, I guess I might as well put into perspective the amount of distance that there is between me and you right now. I am about 20,000 meters away, so as I said before, that's a very far distance, and it means even the speed of light is going to take 0.00001 seconds to reach your eyes through this camera. So technically I'm 0.0001 seconds delayed. So anyways, that's all I'm going to say for this video. If you found this to be educational, then, well, I could just say subscribe, I guess.
Okay, if you can remember, in Samuel Robotham's experiment, at 6 miles away, the boat should have been 16 feet below the horizon.
If the Earth is a sphere with a circumference of 25,000 miles, then over a distance of 6 miles, the second bridge should mathematically be 16 feet below the observer's eye line.
Okay, this guy is twice the distance away, so he should be roughly close to around 90 feet below the horizon, at 8 inches squared per mile. But he's not, is he? You can see him, his whole body, right there, plain as day. And therefore, debunking the second part of Professor Dumb Dave's challenge. Now there's just one little thing left in the challenge that I want to debunk.
Well, every time you whine about this, the objects are always suspiciously close, such that you can fudge the numbers, and they're always over water, so you can lie about refractive effects to people who have no idea how refraction works. And they're always over water, so you can lie about refractive effects to people who have no idea how refraction works.
Okay, now, Professor Dumb Dave is saying that the objects are always filmed over water so that we can lie about the refraction. Now, once again, Professor Dumb Dave is either lying to you or he is really this dumb. Refraction doesn't just happen over water. It also happens over land, especially highways and roads, as you can see here. And especially here in this video, notice the first semi, it looks like his tires disappear. That's due to refraction. Look at the white truck. Notice it looks like the front of his truck is missing, and then all of a sudden it comes back into view. That's refraction. So, as you can see, once again, Professor Dumb Dave is lying to you and talking fast because he knows you know nothing about refraction. And now, with that being said, we have debunked Professor Dumb Dave's number 4 challenge. And that completes this episode of Debunking Professor Dumb Dave. So now, everyone, be sure to join me in episode 5, where we debunk his number 5 challenge. Everyone, thanks for watching. Have a good evening and God bless.
All I'm offering is the truth. Nothing more. Offering is the truth. Nothing more.
Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to Debunking Professor Dumb Dave, Episode 5. Now, as you all know, I usually start the episodes out with reviewing Professor Dumb Dave's reviews, but as I showed you in episode 4, he has went in and deactivated the reviews and we can't take a look at them now. As you can see down here at the bottom, the option is not even there anymore. And of course, those of you who left comments in the comment sections of his videos, he went in and deleted those out, so I'm not able to show those either. So what I am going to do for you in this episode is debunk 2 of Professor Dumb Dave's challenges. Now, we've already debunked number 1, 2, 3, and 4 of his challenges. So in this episode, we're going to be debunking challenge number 5 and challenge number 6. So let's begin with debunking Professor Dumb Dave's number 5 challenge.
This time, I'd like to offer some challenges to you remaining few that are desperately clinging to this dying fad to derive some semblance of self-worth. Let's call them
10 challenges for flat earthers.
Number 5, speaking of things that are far away, you all love whipping out your Nikons so much that I wouldn't be surprised if a Nikon executive dreamt up the entire flat earth hoax as a viral marketing campaign.
Okay, first of all, we can tell that Professor Dumb Dave has no experience with cameras whatsoever, just by him not even being able to pronounce the name of the camera correctly.
You all love whipping out your Nikons. You all love whipping out your Nikons.
Okay, Dumb Dave, it's called a Nikon, not a Nikon. Even Siri should know that. Let's check and see. Hello, Siri.
Go ahead.
What does N-I-K-O-N spell?
Nikon. N-I. K-O-N.
Okay, now I know I didn't have to do that, but this guy claims to be a professor. You would think he would know how to pronounce a five-letter word. And for someone who has supposedly made hundreds of videos and gets on here and schools people about filming and operating with cameras, you would think he would know how to pronounce the name of the camera correctly, especially one of the most popular cameras there is. But anyways, let's move on.
You take a boat that's far away, pull it back into focus, and then marvel at your own brilliance for figuring out how to operate a camera. Well, try this one then. Stay on the boat. Don't cut away. Stay on it until it disappears. How will it disappear? Bottom up, just like everything else. I wonder why you've never put that on YouTube.
Okay, listen to the question again.
Stay on the boat. Don't cut away. Stay on it until it disappears. How will it disappear?
Okay, once again, either Professor Dumb Dave is lying to you and trying to deceive you, or he is really this dumb. So he's saying keep the camera on the boat, and then he's asking how will it disappear? Okay, before we even zoom in on a boat with a camera, let's remember the fact that ever since we were children, we've been taught that when you look out across the ocean with the naked eye, and all of a sudden the boat disappears out of your view, we've been taught that it goes over the curvature of the earth, and that's why you cannot see it no more. And that's just with the naked eye alone. We've been taught that since 1492. Let's let your astrophysicist, Neil deGrasse Tyson, explain that really quick.
So, Neil, you're not a climate scientist, but you're a very distinguished scientist and astrophysicist.
Hey, what's up, Neil? I got like a super important question for you that I've been wondering like my whole life. Okay, is the world round or flat? Because if so, if the world is round, why isn't the water falling out into the space, out into space?
Mikal, you ask a very important question. This concept had eluded all of humanity for centuries. Everyone thought Earth was flat. Why? Because it looked flat. And they posed the same arguments you did. If it was round, stuff would fall off on the other side. You can't have people standing upside down on a round Earth. Here's the thing. We thought Earth was flat before we had seagoing vessels that went beyond the horizon, recognizing that there has to be a curve there, because the ship doesn't always stay in view. So Columbus, when he set sail, the ship eventually disappeared. And you can chase after him and you can keep disappearing. You can keep doing this. This would count as evidence that Earth's surface was curved.
Okay, since Columbus supposedly set sail in 1492, ever since then we've been taught that when you can't see the boat anymore with your naked eye, that it has disappeared over the curvature of the earth. Now, before one of the Glovers jumps in and says, oh, they looked at it through telescopes back then. Well, it would have been impossible to watch Columbus sail over the curvature of the earth in 1492 when the first telescope wasn't even invented until 1608. So, like I said, for 500 years, we've been taught that when you cannot see the boat anymore with your naked eye, that it went over the curvature of the earth. So, just how far away can a person see with the naked eye? The average is about 3 miles, but let's ask Google for those who don't know. Generally, an average height person can see up to 4.5 kilometers. 2.8 miles at sea level. Okay, now let me show you what that looks like. Okay, now here I have some of my Nikon P900 footage. But before we look for the boat with the P900, I want you to understand that right here is 3 miles out. That's as far as you can see with the naked eye. And that would be what they call the vanishing point, which I'll show you right here. Vanishing point. Number one, the point at which receding parallel lines viewed in perspective appear to converge. Now, the vanishing point here would be where the sky meets the water. You can't see beyond that. That is your vanishing point. Number two, the point at which something that has been growing smaller or increasingly faint disappears altogether. Now, what that means is if you watch a boat go out to sea, and if you keep watching that boat, it would eventually get smaller and smaller until it disappears beyond the limit of your vision, which is called the vanishing point. The point where you can't see any further with the naked eye. So they've told us for 500 years that the boat goes over the curvature of the earth, beyond the vanishing point, beyond our line of sight. Now, remembering when they taught us this 500 years ago, that telescopes hadn't been invented yet. And when they told us this 500 years ago, they never knew that 500 years later, we would have a camera to where we could zoom in past that vanishing point, beyond the line of sight of the naked eye, the point where they told us the boat goes over the curvature of the earth. So let's see if the boat disappears over the curvature of the earth once it goes beyond the vanishing point like they told us for 500 years. And we're going to do that by zooming in with the Nikon P900. As you can see, there's no boat at all. You can't see it with the naked eye. But watch this. It supposedly went over the curvature of the earth. But let's zoom in and see. Okay, now you just watched a boat pop right back into view like it was right in front of us. The same boat that they told us went over the curvature of the earth 500 years ago when we couldn't even see that far. So now that we can see that far, we see that the boat did not disappear over the curvature of the earth like they told us that it did 500 years ago. So now that we have proven that it did not go over the curvature of the earth, we have Professor Dumb Dave saying, keep the camera on the boat, keep the camera on the boat, and see if it disappears. Yes, Dumb Dave, it will disappear eventually because of the simple fact that this camera has a vanishing point to it, just like the naked eye had a vanishing point to it. This camera can only see so far away, and then the boat will disappear beyond the limit of the camera's vision, just as the boat disappeared beyond the limit of the vision of our naked eye did. That doesn't mean that it went over the curvature of the earth. It means that it's going so far away that you cannot physically see it anymore. Now, if you still don't understand what I'm trying to tell you, let me break it down to you this way. Here, we have a high school football field. Okay, we have the goalie and we have the bleachers at the other end of this field, and we have the camera on the ground. So what I want you to picture here is that this guy's shorts that we're looking at here, picture his shorts being the boat. Now, watch what happens to his shorts once he gets beyond the vanishing point, the limit of our vision. Now, need I say more? We all know that this football field doesn't have a big curve in it. If it did, it'd be one hell of a game, wouldn't it? The man's shorts disappear due to the law of perspective. The boat disappears due to the law of perspective. The vanishing point. It goes beyond the limit of our vision.
We thought Earth was flat before we had seagoing vessels that went beyond the horizon, recognizing that there has to be a curve there.
So, as you can see, that is a bunch of lying, deceiving bullcrap. And therefore, debunking Professor Dumbdave's number 5 challenge. Now let's move on to challenge number 6.
Number 6, the most hilarious thing about Flat Earth is that the most mundane everyday observations make absolutely no sense in your model. Like a sunset. A small sun above a flat Earth would simply recede high in the sky and get smaller and smaller until it fades away.
Okay, once again, either Dumb Dave is lying and trying to deceive you, or he really is that dumb and doesn't understand the law of perspective. Now listen to what he says one more time.
Like a sunset. A small sun above a flat Earth would simply recede high in the sky and get smaller and smaller until it fades away.
And that's exactly what the sun would do on a flat Earth. Now here's the difference. In the winter solstice, the sun is further away from you. So when the sun sets, it will appear to get smaller the further that it moves away from you. Now, in the summer solstice, the sun is up close. It's making a small circuit. So therefore, it will not appear to get smaller because it's not going very far away. So first, let me show you a sunset in the winter solstice when the sun is furthest away, and you will see that the sun appears to get smaller the further that it moves away from you. Now, before I do the time lapse of this sunset, I'm going to draw a circle around this sun of its position and size at midday, and then I'm going to take the same circle and put it around the sun right at sunset in the evening. And you will see the difference in size. Okay, now you just seen with your own eyes the sun appear to get smaller the further that it moved away. And I didn't even have to put the circle on there to prove that. I just did that in case you double dumb and double blind. Therefore, debunking the first part of your challenge. Now let's move on to the second part of challenge number 6.
It absolutely would not retain the same angular size and set below the horizon.
Yes, it absolutely would appeared to stay the same size in the summer solstice because the sun is in close, making a small circuit. So therefore, it's not moving out away from you. So it's not going to appear to get much smaller in size, as I will demonstrate for you here. As you can see, we have a string tied from one end of the counter to the other in a straight and level line with a level sun moving across a flat Earth, being viewed from above. Now, let's look at the same scene viewed from the perspective of standing on the flat Earth with the box of bottles acting as our horizon line. So I just showed you that in the winter solstice, how the sun appears to get smaller and smaller the further that it moves away from you. And in the summer solstice, as the sun sets behind the horizon, it doesn't appear to change in size very much at all. Therefore, debunking the second part of challenge number 6. Now, let's move on with the rest of the challenge.
It stays the same size because it's unbelievably far away, and it sets below the horizon because the Earth is a sphere that is turning. Even a toddler can understand this. It's so blatantly obvious that you have to resort to your typical ad hoc antics, talking about refractive effects that defy all logic and somehow magically apply to the sun but nothing else.
like I said, we just debunked all the bull crap that he just sat there and said, and it didn't have anything to do with refraction. Simple observation and science.
Why does nothing else but the sun behave that way? Show me a projectile or a plane going below the horizon as it recedes.
Okay, we already did that earlier in the video, but just in case you didn't see it really, really good, here it is for you to see again. Now let's finish this up.
Do something to explain a sunset. Do anything besides making idiotic videos with action movie soundtracks that contradict middle school level science.
Okay, now he's just repeating himself over and over. We did explain it to you, Dumb Dave, with middle school level science, which apparently you still can't figure out, being that you are going for your master's degree in chemistry for a third time in life after failing twice already. And with that being said, we have debunked Professor Dumb Dave's challenge number 6. And being that we debunked challenge number 5 and number 6 here in episode 5, be sure to join me in episode 6 where we debunk Professor Dumb Dave's challenge number 7. Everyone, thanks for watching. Have a good evening and God bless.
All I'm offering is the truth. Nothing more. All I'm offering is the truth. Nothing more.
Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to episode 6 of Debunking Professor Dumb Dave. Now, as you all know, in episode 5, we debunked Professor Dumb Dave's challenge number 5 and challenge number 6. So in this episode, we're going to be debunking his challenge number 7. So let's go check out Professor Dumb Dave's challenge number 7.
This time, I'd like to offer some challenges to you remaining few that are desperately clinging to this dying fad to derive some semblance of self-worth. Let's call them
10 challenges for flat earthers.
Number 7. What the hell is a lunar eclipse to you? Seriously, explain anything about a lunar eclipse. The things you say about solar eclipses are stupid enough, but at least you say something. A lunar eclipse happens when the Earth gets between the Sun and the Moon. That's right, in between. These two objects are not perpetually above a flat plane, and you know it, which is why you're totally silent on lunar eclipses. And if you're going to propose that some other object besides the Earth is what obscures the Moon, good luck trying to demonstrate its existence.
Okay, the lunar eclipse seems to be the most difficult for globers to understand and for most flat earthers to demonstrate. So I'm going to be demonstrating to you how a lunar eclipse takes place on a flat earth in this video. But before I do that, you need to understand, now most flat earthers understand this, that the moon is not a big solid rock. The moon is transparent, a transparent light, just as the Book of Enoch says it is, which means it's basically nothing more than noble gases, which in the case of the moon, plasma. So before I demonstrate a lunar eclipse, I want to take you back to one of my previous videos where I explained to you how the noble gases of the moon work. Check it out. Now, let me show you how to light up noble gases with a Tesla coil. I want you to pay attention to the colors here, especially the neon. Okay, the first and second glass tube are helium and neon, which will emit a constant sky blue light when placed within the field. Now, neon will also emit red and yellow photons as well. The sky looks blue because it is blue. The photons are a specific frequency our eyes interpret as blue. So you have helium, neon, argon, krypton, and xenon. These are the noble gases that make up 1% of the air. So as you see, the sun creates the field, and the noble gases within this field create the light. You could say the sun governs the light, in other words. Now, as you can see here, the daylight and sunrise and sunset colors of neon, which is your sky blues, your yellows, and reds. Remember that, everyone. Sky blue, yellow, and reds. Look for them the next time you watch the sunset. Now, the moon is also made up of these noble gases. As you can see right here, the moon is transparent, which explains why you can see through one side of it, as you see here. Remembering what I taught you before, the electromagnetic field of the sun is pulling on the fields of the earth as it passes over the earth, just as it pulls on the magnetic field of the moon as it passes it. Just like the earth's light is transparent, but when you concentrate and intensify the discharge of photons, it becomes impossible to see through. As you can see here, the sun on one side of the moon is intensifying the discharge of photons, but you've been taught that it's reflecting the sun's light. But it's the electromagnetic field of the sun lighting up the photons being discharged from the moon gases, making it impossible to see through like you can on the right side of it. And therefore, now you know how you get your moon phases. As you can see here, the sun is making its circuit around the right side of the moon now, and then it's eventually going to be in front of it. Now, when it's directly in front of it, that's when you have your full moon. And as it works its way around its circuit, it will be passing on the left side of the moon, which will give you your third and fourth phase of the moon. So just like the gases in the sky, or just like the gases in the moon, you can't see them until the sun intensifies them and discharges their photons. Which means Professor Armand R. Foster was right when he stated that the moon was made of plasma in 1965.
Questions related to thoughts of genius. Do you think or consider yourself to be a genius?
No. I consider myself to be an ordinary, humble person who wants to serve mankind with what man has striven for from the beginning of consciousness, with truth and understanding of the world.
Well, now, one thing, you have a theory about the moon, and we expect to be able to get observable facts about the moon fairly soon. What is your theory?
Well, it is by now rather more than a theory. 10 or 11 years ago, I stated to various scientists that the moon is not a piece of rock, but it is a plasma phenomenon, a cosmic plasma, and that this fact will eventually be confirmed. I made certain predictions which were already confirmed in 1958, and the situation now is coming close to a complete confirmation.
What will be the result if you are proved to be correct in your theories?
The result will be profound and decisive, because it will give proof that a complete reinvestigation of the laws of nature is necessary. Because if the moon is a plasma, no man will ever land on it. The soft landing attempts will all fail. That means that the mass of the moon is less, far less, than is currently assumed. It's in a different state of energy, and it has far less mass. That means there is no more explanation for the tides. If the moon, for example, had only a thousandth part of its current mass, then the tides would only be 2 inches high, and the conventional theories instead of sometimes 14 feet. And that means that if it is proved that the moon is a plasma, then all gravitational theories are out, and a new concept of the cosmos and of its laws has to be evolved. But the moon is definitely, as I assert, a plasma, this crisis. So it comes again to the age-old concept that truth is the guidance, the hope, and the directive of the human mind, and that man must strive to understand and to know the real nature of the world.
Plasma, an ionized gas consisting of positive ions and free electrons in proportions resulting in more or less no overall electric charge. So, as you can see, like I said, the professor was right. Now, just in case you are still confused on how the transparent moon works with the sun, I'm going to demonstrate it for you as simple as I can demonstrate it. Okay, here, now check this out. Okay, so I'm going to step out back here for a second so you can see that this background is not fake. This is really what it looks like out back right now. Okay, now let's step back inside the screen door here. Now, here's what I want you to pay attention to. See how you still see the little playground there? But also at the same time, you see my face, my head, my hand through the playground. Or actually see the playground through my head and face. Now, let's say the playground is the sky above, and my head and face are the moon. Okay? So you see how my head and face are transparent? That's how the moon is at all times until the sun excites the photons in the gases of the moon. And when that happens, the light from the gases are so bright, you cannot see through them. So let me give you an example of what I'm talking about. Now let's use the energy of the sun. Okay, now you see how my face lights up so bright you can't see the playground through it? And if I move the sun to one side of my face, it lights up one side of my face, but the other side of my face is still transparent and you can see the playground through it. That's how the moon works. When the sun excites the photons of the gases of the moon. And that is how you can see through one side of the moon, but not the other. So, now that you understand how the transparent moon works, let's move on with demonstrating how the lunar eclipse works. Okay, now remembering that an eclipse can only happen either on a full moon or a new moon. A total eclipse takes place when the sun is very close to the moon and passing right over the moon, which would be a new moon. And I explained it in a previous video like this right here. Okay, the sun and moon are like the minute and the hour hand on the face of a clock, pretending that this face of this clock is the face of the flat earth. With the sun being the minute hand and the moon being the hour hand, the sun will eventually pass over the top of the moon, just like the minute hand will eventually pass over the top of the hour hand, causing what we know as an eclipse, as you can see here. And like I said, the total eclipse can only happen with a new moon, which means the sun and moon are right there together. The sun passes right over the moon. And as the sun passes right over the top of the moon, that's where you get your totality at. You can't see the sun because it's moving across the top of the moon, which excite the photons only on the top of the moon, therefore making it so bright, impossible to see through. But you can't see that brightness because it's facing the sun. The sun's passing over the top of it. We're seeing it from the bottom side, which is why we see blackness. But the lunar eclipse is totally the opposite. A lunar eclipse can only happen during a full moon, which means the sun is on one side of the flat disk Earth and the moon is on the other. And they are not side by side like in a solar eclipse. So with the sun being on one side of the flat disk Earth and the moon being on the other, that's kind of halfway right about what science tells you. You know, you got a full moon because the sun's directly in front of it on the other side of the earth. So on the side of the earth that's dark at nighttime, you can't see the sun's light because you're on the ground. But if you were way up in the sky where the moon's at, you would still see the sun's light because you would be up high enough to see across the flat plane of the earth. So like I said, even though you can't see the sun's light from the ground, you can still see the sun's light from the height of the moon. And therefore, that's how you get your lunar eclipse. The moon still has to cross the path of the sun's light, but from the opposite side of the flat disk Earth. And now I'm going to demonstrate how that causes a lunar eclipse. Now, the lunar eclipse lasts about 4 hours. That's about how long it takes the moon to pass across the light of the sun as it's making its circuit around the flat disk Earth. Now, I want you to pay attention. Watch this one more time. Okay, now here we have the full moon, which, as you all know, on the flat Earth, it makes its circuit clockwise, just as the sun does. okay? But if the sun's on the other side of the earth, it still has to cross the light of that sun. Now I'm going to show you what happens when it crosses the light of that sun on the other side of the earth. Now watch the shadow on the moon as we make our circuit around the earth. We eventually cross over the path of the sun on the other side of the earth. Check out the shadow. Okay, here's your lunar eclipse right here. You see the shadow move up? It stays on there for 4 hours till the moon passes back, and then it goes off the other side of it. Same thing here with the lunar eclipse. See how it comes up the left side? It stays on the moon for 4 hours, and then it comes off the right top side. Same thing here. Once again, comes up the left, shadow of darkness for 4 hours, then boom, it comes back up the right top side of the moon. One more time, check it out. Then we have darkness across the moon for 4 hours, then bam, it goes right back off the other side. And that can only happen with a transparent moon making a circuit around a flat earth. And therefore, come on, you guys say it with me. Debunking Professor Dumb Dave's number 7 challenge. And bringing us to the end of episode 6. But everyone join me in episode 7 as we debunk Professor Dumb Dave's challenge number 8. Hey everyone, thanks for watching. Have a good evening and God bless.
All I'm offering is the truth. Nothing. All I'm offering is the truth.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to episode 7 of Debunking Professor Dumb Dave. Okay, for those of you who are keeping up with the episodes, you know we are on the last 3 challenges of Dumb Dave's 10 challenges for flat earthers. And in the last couple weeks, we have debunked 7 of those challenges. So come and join me now as we debunk challenge number 8.
This time, I'd like to offer some challenges to you remaining few that are desperately clinging to this dying fad to derive some semblance of self-worth. Let's call them
10 challenges for flat earthers.
Number 8, speaking of the sun and moon being small and close to the earth, what is stopping you from strapping a camera to a weather balloon and sending it up there? Go get up close and personal with either of these objects and take some pictures. If you get crafty with some robotics, which is a stretch given your complete lack of education, you could even scoop up a little sample. Maybe the moon is made of cheese after all. Can't you get even halfway there such that the sizes change? Reach for the sky, fellas.
Okay, now this is an easy one. We've been strapping cameras onto high-altitude balloons for many, many years now. So either Professor Dumb Dave is just too dumb to realize that, or he's, once again, lying and trying to deceive you. Now, I'm going to lean more towards he's trying to deceive you on this one, because the average person hasn't really seen any video footage of cameras being strapped to high altitude balloons. But before we do that, I'm going to show Professor Dumb Dave that you can see the sun and moon from an airplane straight across from each other over the flat disk, especially in the summer solstice when the sun and moon are lower in altitude. So let's see what the sun and moon look like directly across from each other in the same sky over a flat earth.
And God made 2 great lights, the greater light to rule the day and the lesser light to rule the night.
As you can see here in this high altitude balloon footage, you can see the moon over on the dark side of the flat earth, while we have the sun right here on the daytime side of the flat earth. Okay, now in this high altitude balloon footage, just as in the footage before this one, you can see the hot spot on the clouds underneath the sun, proving that the sun is close and local. That's the only way you can have a hot spot. So, there is your camera up close to the sun and moon, Professor Dumb Dave. And there is your proof that the sun and moon are up there together making their circuit around the flat earth disk, as you could see with the airplane footage and the high altitude balloon footage with your own eyes. And therefore, debunking Professor Dumb Dave's challenge number 8 and ending this episode. Everyone, be sure and join me in the next episode where we debunk challenge number 9. Everyone, thanks for watching. Have a good day and God bless.
All I'm offering is the truth. Nothing. I'm offering is the truth. Nothing.
Dum
Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to episode 8 of Debunking Professor Dumb Dave. Today we're going to be debunking challenge number 9, which is not really a challenge at all, but we're going to go ahead and entertain the thought.
This time I'd like to offer some challenges to you remaining few that are desperately clinging to this dying fad to derive some semblance of self-worth. Let's call them
10 challenges for flat earthers.
Number 9, take some flights, like any direct flight in the southern hemisphere. Whoops, shouldn't that be impossible? Better yet, fly between two cities two different ways, the shortest way on the globe and the shortest way on the flat earth. Which one do you think will be faster? I'm just joking. I know that none of you will ever be employed long enough to afford a private jet.
Okay, this is coming from a guy who can't seem to keep a job long enough to get his master's and who spends 60 to 70 hours a week locking himself in his bedroom at his parents' house.
But through a bunch of bureaucracy, quite frankly, I lost that job and along with it, the funding for my master's program. So I had to withdraw yet again from the master's program.
Somebody come and look at this. Look at this.
I lost that job and along with it, the funding for my master's program. So I had to withdraw yet again from the master's program. I sit literally in this room like 60 to 70 hours a week. I sit literally in this room like 60 to 70 hours a week.
You shouldn't cast stones when you live in a glass house there, Dumb Dave. Okay, so he's saying take a flight and see which one is shorter on the globe earth or the flat earth map, okay? Well, Professor Dumb Dave, they are both the same. The only difference is they tell you that you're flying around a globe and they show you a curved flight pattern on the so-called globe. But once you convert that flight pattern over to the flat earth map, you will find out that it's a perfect straight line, and I'll use a couple flights here just to show you how that works.
But I noticed something strange while booking my Asian getaway. My plane seems to be making a detour over Alaska. Why is my plane going out of its way to avoid the Pacific Ocean? Is this a mistake? Did I accidentally sign up for the Caribou route? At first, you might think this was a safety issue. The Pacific is the largest and deepest of the world's oceans. If a plane encounters a problem over a seemingly endless and bottomless pond of water, the pilots are going to have a rough time finding a safe spot to set her down. Alaska might not be overpopulated with international airports, but it's a lot better than the middle of the ocean. How's that for a tourism slogan? Alaska. At least it's better than sinking.
Now, let me show you the real true reason why we have to fly over Alaska just to get to Asia. Check this out. Now, here's the flight pattern on a globe. The guy leaves Seattle, Washington, flies over Alaska, kind of curves around the so-called globe, and lands in Asia. Okay. Now, if you still don't get it, let me break it down to you this way. On a globe map, all the pilot had to do was leave Seattle, Washington, fly straight across the sea to Asia, which would have been the shortest route. Fuel-wise, whatever you want to call it, that would have been the shortest route. But he can't do that because it's impossible. Now, let me show you why he takes the route that he takes.
Now, let's have a look at the same route on a flat earth map. Okay, here we have the United States, the west coast of the United States. Here we have Asia, which is where the guy went. Well, look what's right in between. Alaska. So if you leave here, go into Asia, guess where you're gonna fly across? Alaska.
Let me zoom in on the map so you guys can see just a little bit better here. As you can see right there, Alaska, right in between Asia and the United States. Now, let's put a marker on there so you guys can see it's a straight line, straight across. Alaska is right in between. So as you can see, they don't choose to fly that route. They have no choice but to fly that route. Now let's check out a flight from New York to Moscow, Russia. Okay, now if you look up the flight pattern on Google Maps, it will show you a route leaving New York, going through the tip of Canada, then through the tip of Greenland, then through the tip of Iceland, through Sweden, and then into Moscow. Now let me zoom in on this map so you guys can see that better. Like I said, it leaves New York, goes through the tip of Canada, through the tip of Greenland, through the tip of Iceland, over Sweden, and then into Moscow. Now, doesn't that strike a little bit awkward with you guys? I mean, anybody with common sense knows that the fastest route between A and B is in a straight line, as we see here. I mean, you do not have to be a rocket scientist to figure this out. It's common sense. From point A to point B is a straight line that will always be the fastest and shortest route. So anyways, on a globe, this would be your shortest route from New York to Moscow. But instead, this is the route that they give you. Now, I'm going to show you why they take this route. Let's go to the Flat Earth map. Now, check out what you have to pass to get from New York to Moscow on a Flat Earth map, a straight line. Check this out. The edge of Canada, the edge of Greenland, straight over Iceland, straight over Sweden, and into Moscow. Huh, imagine that. There you go. Now it makes sense. The flight pattern makes total sense on a Flat Earth map because it has to go straight across those countries to get to Moscow. Now, I'm assuming Professor Dumb Dave doesn't know this one because he's not familiar with the Flat Earth map or how it works. Therefore, debunking the first part of Professor Dumb Dave's challenge. Now, let's move on to the second part of the challenge.
But next time you're on a regular plane, notice that flights going east or west are not constantly turning slightly to one side, as you seem to believe they all must be. Yeah, you would notice that. If humanity is unfortunate enough that you've actually procreated, send your kid up to the cockpit to meet the pilot and snap a pic of the wheel. What do you know? Straight as an arrow.
Well, of course the wheel would be straight as an arrow. So let's help educate Professor Dumb Dave as to why that is. And as in doing so, we will also teach him how the compass works on the Flat Earth map so he will understand how the wheel stays straight.
Down here we have what looks kind of like a compass. It acts kind of like a compass, but it's not a compass at all. It's called a directional gyro, and it can be synced with the magnetic compass, which is on the dashboard, and it can be used for sort of aiding in headings and heading holding. The mag compass, as trusty as it is, sometimes is a little unreliable. It bounces around in there, so this is an easier way to see what heading you're flying and holding headings. In this case, it actually gives you a digital readout of the current heading you're holding, which right now we're just a little bit north of west. We're at 276 degrees. Of course, 270 is a west heading.
Now, in order to understand this, first you have to understand how magnetism works. For example, right now this compass is pointing to the true North Pole. But let's see what happens to the needle on the compass when I alter the magnetic field. Bam! That's the same thing the North Pole does. It automatically pulls that needle to it. So now this magnet is our North Pole. Now I've already magnetized the center of this Flat Earth map by placing a magnet in the center of it, which will automatically pull the needle of the compass to the center of the map, which will be the North Pole. Now let me show you one more time how the needle of the compass is pointing to the real true North Pole right now. But watch when I drop it to a smaller scale. Watch where the needle automatically points to. The center of the Flat Earth map, the North Pole. Now let's watch as we go east around the Flat Earth map. Notice the E stays in the direction that we're moving the compass, which is east, and the needle stays fixed on the North Pole. Now, let's show you an example of a flight right here. Let's say we're going from Dubai to Asia. Okay, now let's do a flight from Asia to California. Okay, now let's go from California to Europe. Now you notice how the compass pointed east all the way around the flat disk Earth to each one of those destinations? That's because the magnetic North Pole will always be pulling the needle of that compass to the center of the map. And Professor Dumdave is trying to tell you that in order to do this, you would constantly have to be veering the plane to the left. Now, yes, you would have to veer to the left a slight bit if you were circumnavigating the whole disk, but that's not the case. We're talking about from flight to flight. On each flight, you're going to set your coordinates, and the plane is going to follow that coordinates, which is going to be in a straight line. Now, say, for instance, this flight from California to Europe. You wouldn't make a veer to the left during that flight because you would already set your coordinates, and it would be in a straight line. The wheel of the plane would be straight all the way there. And it would be the same if you were flying west, as you can see here, going from Europe back to California. As you notice, the compass is pointing west, with the needle still pointing to the North Pole. And you go back the other way, it points to the east. So Professor Dumdave is trying to convince you that from going from east to west, that you would be veering to the left, and going from west to east, you would be veering to the right constantly. But that's not the case at all, as you can see here. Once you set that coordinates from one destination to the other, it's a perfect straight line, which means the steering wheel of the plane will stay straight all the way there.
Notice that flights going east or west are not constantly turning slightly to one side, as you seem to believe they all must be.
No, Professor Dumdave, you seem to believe they must be. And I just showed you with common sense that that is not the case at all. Therefore, come on, everyone, say it with me. Debunking Professor Dumdave's number 9 challenge. And that will bring us to the end of episode number 8. Everyone, be sure to join me in episode 9 as we debunk Professor Dumdave's last challenge out of the 10 challenges. Everyone, thanks for watching. Have a good evening, and God bless.
All I'm offering is the truth. Nothing more. All I'm offering is the truth.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to Debunking Professor Dumdave, Episode 9. Now, if you're getting confused on the episodes, the reason we have challenge number 10 in episode 9 is because we did challenge number 5 and challenge number 6 in episode 5. So therefore, that only gives us 9 episodes. Therefore, leaving some people thinking that they miss an episode. But no, that's not the case. Just challenge number 5 and number 6 was so short, not very big challenges at all. I put them both in episode number 5. So, anyways, let's move on with debunking challenge number 10.
This time, I'd like to offer some challenges to you remaining few that are desperately clinging to this dying fad to derive some semblance of self-worth. Let's call them
10 challenges for flat earthers.
And number 10, do anything legitimately scientific at all. Publish anything whatsoever about your model in anything reputable anywhere.
And once again, either Professor Dumdave is just too dumb to know this, or he's lying to you and trying to deceive you. But there are many books published about the flat earth in reputable outlets. And you can easily go online and find those. For example, here, we have Abe Books, a reputable outlet. Now let's see what we have. Why the Earth is Not a Globe by Vincent Rhodes. Okay, 2019. price, $10.50. And here we have 100 proofs that Earth is not a globe, 2017 updated edition by William Carpenter. 3 stars. You can buy a new copy for $9.03 or a used copy for $6.38. Okay, and here we have Zetetic Astronomy, Earth, Not a Globe, by Samuel Burley Robotham. Let's stroll down here. Look at that. 4 stars. Price, $9.77. And here we have The Greatest Lie on Earth, Expanded Edition, Proof that Our World is Not a Moving Globe, by Edward Hendry. 4-star rating. Price, $51.91. So, anyways, like I said, Professor Dumb Dave is either really that dumb or he's just trying to deceive you and lying to you. So, anyways, we debunk the first part of the challenge. Now let's move on to the second part of the challenge.
Invent any technology based on your model. Do anything at all that could be considered actual empirical science. Here's a hint. You may have to study some real science to do it, but then of course you would immediately learn that the Earth isn't flat, so it probably won't be of much use.
Okay, need I say it again? Either Professor Dumb Dave is really this dumb or he's just lying to you and trying to deceive you. So let's show Professor Dumb Dave some empirical science that's been here long before they ever came along and lied to us and told us that the Earth was a globe. And we'll start out with the sundial, the world's oldest known sundial from Egypt's Valley of Kings, 1500 BC, used to measure work hours. The earliest household clocks known from the archaeological finds are the sundials, 1500 BC in ancient Egypt and ancient Babylonian astronomy. Now let me explain to you how the sundial works. A sundial is a horological device that tells the time of day when direct sunlight shines by the apparent position of the sun in the sky. In the narrowest sense of the word, it consists of a flat plate and a gnomon, which casts a shadow onto the dial. And I myself am going to show you how that works on the time calculator of the Gleason's Flat Earth Map. You see, the sun has to be in the sky, and the sun itself has to be rotating in its clockwise circuit for the sundial to work. The ancient Egyptians, Babylonians, the Incas, the Mayans, this is how they told time. This is how they kept track of time and days and months and years for thousands and thousands of years, because they knew that they lived on a flat earth with a sun making its circuit around the disc of the flat earth. That's how this sundial works. And this is imperial science that was here thousands of years before they ever came along and said that the earth was a sphere, a globe. And that right there alone debunks your second part of challenge number 10. But I'm going to throw a little bonus in from a real scientist.
There's all kinds of proofs right around you that show that the Earth is flat. A very simple one to think of is that we use plumb bobs to build buildings. In other words, to get the wall of a building going straight down, you'll take a string with a heavy weight hanging from it, and you make the building follow that string. That plumb bob will point to the center of a round earth. That means that if you imagine that this was the correct earth, you can imagine a plumb bob held here would point in that direction, and a plumb bob held here would point in that direction. That means the buildings would be bigger on the top than at the bottom.
So anyways, Professor Dumb Dave, there's your imperial science. And I do have to say, this was your most weakest and easiest challenge to debunk. So, for the last and final time, everybody say it with me. We have debunked Professor Dumb Dave's challenge number 10. And therefore, that brings us to the end of the episode and to the end of this series of debunking Professor Dumb Dave's 10 challenges. And being that we've done this in 9 episodes, I'm going to feature a bonus episode in a few hours for those of you who want a good laugh at Professor Dundave one last time. Anyways, everyone, thanks for watching. Have a good morning, and God bless.
All I'm offering is the truth. Nothing more. All I'm offering is the truth. Nothing more.
Good evening, everyone, and welcome to Debunking Professor Dumdave Update. Unfortunately, we can't review Professor Dumdave's reviews today because he has went into the settings and deactivated his reviews. Now, they would normally be right down here at the bottom, as you can see right here, but they are totally gone. Now, we all know, of course, that he did that to prevent any of his normal viewers and followers from seeing the comments where he's been debunked and seeing the comments where he's being called a fraud and being put in the spotlight for being a liar and just plain out dumb. And I'd say the primary reason that he did this was to stop his star rating from continuing to drop. He was already down to, I think, 3.1 earlier today from a 3.5 yesterday. So congratulations to everyone and good job for going on there and calling him out for the lying, deceiving, dumb Dave clown that he is. So, yes, he did find a way to crawl out of that little situation that he got himself into. But all you have to do now is hit on home right here and stroll down. And as you'll see right here, his videos will start. Right here's the first one. Check out my new channel, blah, 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 supposedly in Spanish. Just stroll down to the comments here and do the same thing you were doing on the reviews. Put your comments in his videos, and I guarantee you, he'll go in and deactivate the comments on all of his videos. Because the last thing he wants is his viewers and his followers to see how dumb and how much of a liar and deceiver that he really is. So anyways, aside of that, I know all you guys are looking forward to watching episode 4 of Debunking Professor Dumdave. Unfortunately, I didn't have time to get to episode 4 today. I am in the middle of working on it and I'm almost done with it. I just didn't have time to finish it up today. I was really busy. But sometime tomorrow, I will release Debunking Professor Dumdave episode 4. So in the meantime, you guys continue to expose this clown for the liar and the deceiver that he is, and I'll continue to stay busy working on the rest of the episodes. Also, in the meantime, feel free to watch episodes 1, 2, and 3 again and share them with everyone you know. The more, the merrier, right? And once again, just want to give a big thank you to everyone for helping expose and spread the truth. Everyone, thanks for watching. Have a good night. And God bless.
All I'm offering is the truth. Nothing more. All I'm offering is the truth. Nothing more. Dum 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 d
And today I want to address another question that I get very frequently in regards to my career background and educational background. A lot of you want to know where I went to school and what I studied, and a lot of you want to know if I currently teach in the flesh, and if so, where. And furthermore, a lot of you ask very incredulously, are you a real professor? So I wanted to knock out all of these all at once and just sort of give you a quick summary of my my life and career since college. I went to Minnesota for college. I went to a liberal arts school called Carleton College, which is a really great place. And while I was there, I got a bachelor's degree in chemistry. And immediately after that, I went over to California. I went to UC Santa Cruz to do a master's program in synthetic organic chemistry. But I didn't really last long. I dropped out in my second semester. I wanted to move up to San Francisco and play music. So I was there a couple years playing in some different bands. And then I moved down to Los Angeles, again, for music opportunities. And but I eventually got this teaching job for organic chemistry at this little trade university here in the LA area. They offered me the job permanently, but contingent on me getting a master's at the same time. So I went over to Cal State Northridge to give a second shot at a master's degree in chemistry. But through a bunch of bureaucracy, quite frankly, I lost that job, and along with it, the funding for my master's program. So I had to withdraw yet again from the master's program.
Somebody come and look at this. Look at this.
I lost that job, and along with it, the funding for my master's program. So I had to withdraw yet again from the master's program, and that was the birth of Professor Dave Explains. And I chose the name really without much thought. I just thought it'd be fun to have like a little persona, you know, Professor Dave. It's just, you know, a little name.
Okay. 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 Okay.
I'm back in school for a third attempt at a master's degree. I'm back in school for a third attempt at a master's degree, this time in science education, so it's a little bit different. And I'll be done in the spring. But to be honest, I really don't have any desire to go back to teaching after that, because I'm doing this full time. I sit literally in this room like 60 to 70 hours a week. I sit literally in this room like 60 to 70 hours a week.
Man, you are one pathetic loser. No offense.
No, none taken.
Well, 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 imagine that. Here we have a guy who labeled himself a professor, who dropped out of college because he couldn't complete his master's and became a musician, and then gets a job teaching chemistry, and in order to keep that job, he has to complete his master's, which again, he fails to do and loses his job because he can't complete his master's. And who is now trying to complete his master's for a third time, sitting in an isolated bedroom at his parents' house 60 to 70 hours a week, proclaiming to be a professor with only a degree in chemistry. I don't know which is dumber, this guy proclaiming to be a professor or the people who actually subscribe, watch, listen, and believe that this guy is a professor. And globe earthers call flat earthers dumb, while at the same time using this two-time college dropout professor wannabe as their poster boy to back up their illusional belief system of the globe.
We got some dumbass motherfuckers floating around this country. Dumbass motherfuckers, you know? Yeah. It's fucking embarrassing. Only a nation of unenlightened half-wits could have taken this beautiful place and turned it into what it is today.
And these people, like Professor Dumb Dave, sit in a bedroom 60 to 70 hours a week, proclaiming that the Earth is a globe, but hasn't been out of the bedroom long enough to even observe anything on this flat Earth, like an eclipse, a sunset, a boat going into the horizon, the sun and moon in the same sky at the same time, or noticing the same stars in the same sky every night for the last 5,000 years. And the sad thing about it is these people will willfully remain ignorant as long as they believe in liars and deceivers like Professor Dumb Dave. And I have cast him out to be viewed by everyone for the fraud that he is, and therefore ending the Dumb Dave series. And with that being said, I just want to give a big thank you to everyone out there who tuned in to each episode. It was you guys who made it such a fun series to do. Anyways, everyone, thanks for watching. Have a good evening, and God bless.
All I'm offering is the truth. Nothing.
Hi everyone, it's me, not a Professor Douchebag Dave. It's really fun to lie and pretend to be things that you're not. I love to pretend to be a professor. I love pretending to be smart. I pretend often that I'm not a douche, or that I'm good-looking, or that I'm straight. Who doesn't love to pretend? I'm a big fan of pretend things like evolution, spherical Earths, gigantic suns, and sexual intercourse. So hope you are all well. And yes, I am still lying about being a professor. And yeah, I'm super afraid to debate Austin, unless of course he agrees to debate me handcuffed and gagged with duct tape around his mouth. What a fucking pussy, right? Debate me on my terms, Austin, you little fucking pussy. Oh, poor baby can't debate when he can't use his words. What a little baby. Anyways, as you can see by my immaculate house behind me, I've actually never sat on that couch or even had a female over. Well, one time I picked up one of those Princess Leia dolls and she came over, but I'm not quite sure if that counts. Anyways, before I go, I have to confess something. I'm secretly in love with Flat Earth Dave. No, not because he is so damn sexy. Or because he is so fucking cool. It's because of his fucking Flat Earth clock app. That thing just gets better and better. I am addicted to the New Earth trivia game. I never knew how stupid I was. Okay, that's it for now. I really know the Earth is flat, but if I admit it, YouTube will stop getting me the views, and then I won't be able to pay my mommy the rent money for my ground floor apartment.